Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us today for this webinar provided by Toradex on use of secure boot to help secure your embedded Linux devices. We're glad you could join us. I know your time is valuable, so we appreciate any time you're able to give us to listen to us speak. Just a few organizational points. Use the chat for any technical issues. We have a few folks on the line. If you're having audio issues or anything like that, they'll do their best to get you squared away. I won't be involved in that, but they should be able to handle that. A recording will be provided after the session. There is time at the end for Q&A. Feel free to post your questions in the chat window at any time. For some simple things, they may get those questions answered while I'm still talking. Otherwise, we'll deal with them at the end. My name is Drew Mosley. I'm a solutions architect here at Toradex with a focus on the entire Torizon stack. So everything from the operating system through the cloud platform, all the services, API, IDE developer tools, things like that. I am not a member of the core dev team, but I am an interface for our users and customers back to the dev team. So if we haven't met yet, chances are we will soon. I'm here to help figure out what your requirements are and how we can make our product better overall. So just briefly, we'll start with kind of a quick agenda. I think it's pretty straightforward. We're going to talk about what secure boot is, why is it important, talk about some of the attack scenarios it protects against, and also some of the things it doesn't protect against. As we'll see, secure boot is not a panacea that fixes every problem, but it is one component of an overall security mindset. Then we'll talk about a little bit of the actual specific details of how it's implemented with Torizon, and specifically how it's implemented on top of the IMX 6, 7, and 8 processors that our modules are based on, and then some of the workflows that involve our tools. And finally, we'll go into a demo. I've got kind of a pre-canned thing here. You won't have to watch me doing all the Yocto builds and things like that, because that clearly takes too long. But I've got the cooking show style set up here with everything ready to go. Just before we dive into secure boot, let's just share a little bit about who we are at Toradex in case you're unfamiliar with us. Our main focus is making computing easy. We aim to make it easy for integrators to use our hardware and software in their products. We make ARM-based system on modules based on both Texas Instruments and NXP SoCs, and we provide the full software stack in giving you all the connectivity as part of the Torizon system, including platform services for things like over-the-air updates and that kind of thing. We have an extensive support organization providing best-in-class customer support with engineers worldwide to give the best coverage possible to get your questions answered as quickly as feasible. Our main markets are shown here, include things like healthcare, transportation, and others. You see that security and reliability, of course, are very important to all of our customers, and we do cover some markets where that is extremely important. Customer volumes typically in the few hundreds to a few tens of thousands of devices per year, although we do have some customers with both smaller and larger fleets. And as you see here, this is our product portfolio. We have a number of modules based on the NXP i.MX family of processors. We have IMX 6, 7, and 8 across three families, Calibri, Verit, and Palace. And we have a new processor, a new module based on the TI AM62 that has just been recently released. And additionally, not shown here, that was just announced yesterday as our new Titan EVK i.MX 95 evaluation kit that we are developing in partnership with NXP. And if you're new to Torizon, that's kind of the focus of this talk. Torizon, as I mentioned, is our system to help simplify the development and maintenance of all embedded Linux devices. As the developer, you get a pre-built Yocto-based image that you can use without having to become a Yocto expert. We have a number of partners that provide application stacks, GUI frameworks, things like that make it easy for you to include those in your application. And we have a very nice Visual Studio Code integration, a plugin for the Visual Studio Code IDE that makes it very easy to just jump in, get started writing your code, and without having to deal with learn all the complexity of containers and SSH access and cross compilation and all that. That gets hidden from you unless and until you actually need to know those details. A little bit more about Torizon. Obviously time to market is critical. In addition to the operating system, which we will be looking at today, Secure Boot is primary client side thing. It also includes the cloud platform that goes along with the system, that includes things like over the air updates, device and fleet monitoring, and just the ability to help monitor your entire device fleet through its lifetime, troubleshoot issues, spot problems, keep the devices updated and secure from emerging threats. All right, so before we get started into the actual discussion of Secure Boot, I wanted to launch a poll here just to get a sense of where everybody is. We'll go ahead and launch this first poll. All right, we're getting good responses here. All right, I think that's good enough. It's the numbers have been stable for a few minutes, so we'll come back over here to the slides and let's show the results of this poll. Not terribly surprising, about what I expected. Only one person has never heard of it. Well, I hope you get something out of this. The majority of you have never used it, but a few have used it on ARM, and even a few on x86. Of course, Secure Boot on x86 is kind of different than what we're implementing here, but the principles are still the same. So that's all great information. Hopefully everybody will get more out of this talk. All right, so let's move on. So let's first talk about why we want Secure Boot. What is the main goal of Secure Boot, and what does it provide you? And for a lot of our customers in particular, security and regulatory compliance becomes a big issue. The ultimate goal is to guarantee that the end customer safety and security. And there are lots of regulations coming out that require something like Secure Boot. You see a couple, the EU Cyber Resilience Act, FDA in the US has a few things at least proposed. I'm not sure exactly what the status of them are. And I know there are lots of others in various governments around the world. And really the ultimate aim of Secure Boot is to guarantee that the booting image on your device is trusted and has not been tampered with. Right. Anytime you get hit by a vulnerability of any kind, it's very difficult to know if you've cleaned it out completely. And so the aim of Secure Boot is to let you know that you are running exactly the image that you're expecting to run. All right. So let's go ahead and do the second poll. Just to kind of get a sense of where we are in terms of requirements to actually use Secure Boot. All right, I think that's good enough. Numbers seem to have stabilized. So we'll go ahead and share those results. It's about what I expected. I like to see that a lot of people want to use it as best practice. Only a few people say they don't have any regulatory requirements. We do have some customers in consumer industries and things like that that maybe don't have regulatory requirements. Looks like about a third of you had actual requirements, regulatory requirements that necessitate Secure Boot. So that's really, really interesting information. All right, so let's move on into some of the more interesting detailed stuff here. So we talked about the aim. What is it at a little more detailed level? And the quote here, focuses on two things, right? It's all the processes, workflows, and tools enabling the device itself at boot time to verify both the authenticity and the integrity of the booting image. And those words have very specific meanings here. Authenticity in this case is a guarantee that the image comes from a verified and trusted source. So you know that your images are coming in the case of Toradex. If you're booting our images, you're able to verify that they're the images that we created. Normally, it's going to be the custom images that you have created, and so you want to make sure that the device is running authentic code that was came from your source of truth. And integrity, of course, is the guarantee that the image has not been tampered with. So these two features together are what provide the ability of Secure Boot to actually verify that the code you're running is actually what you're expecting to run. So a little bit about naming. Secure boot is the term we use. There's a bunch of different names. I think verified boot is a name, I believe, that comes from Android. In the desktop PC space, you'll hear UEFI secure boot, I believe. It's very tied into UEFI. There's some other things. You see a couple of the names here. But they all basically mean the same thing, right? The intent of any of these features is to make sure you're running the images that you have verified and they have not been tampered with. So a lot of times people come in expecting to hear about things like encryption and TPM. Those are really unrelated to secure boot, although they can be used in tandem with secure boot. Secure boot does not require encryption. It does not provide confidentiality of your images. It only provides authenticity and integrity checking. So encryption is not generally considered part of secure boot. TPM is not needed in the case of Torizon and Toradex for the IMX processors. There's a subsystem onboard the SoC called AHAB or HAB, depending on which version of the SoC you're using. And for the AM62, it's a subsystem called HSM. So there's enough functionality built into the hardware that we are able to make use of that without needing a TPM. So this is kind of the big picture view, and it all comes down to what we call a chain of trust. So you kind of see the main boot flow here, and so it always starts with the SoC ROM code. This is code that's baked into the SoC itself. We don't have access to it. You, as the user of the device, don't have access to it. Generally, details about it are hidden behind, in the case of NXP, you know, your NXP.com account. You know, it's not generally published code. But at that point, you know, it's the chain of trust, starting with that public key on the very left, all the way through to the root file system on the right. But be careful. Enabling secure boot in a device is a one-time operation. So when we see the details later, we're actually programming fuses in the SoC to enable that public key. So on the very left here, you see pub key 1 in the SoC. That is actually, you're actually fusing that key into the SoC, and for security reasons and to avoid certain attack scenarios, that's a one-time operation. You cannot undo that. And that implies that you have to maintain access to those keys. You know, you need to follow good key management practices, probably store them offline in some kind of air gap system, have some proper means of backup so that you know where those keys are at all time. And there is a mechanism for rotating keys. I won't go into any detail about that today. That's kind of beyond the basics of secure boot. But, you know, if you do lose access to one of your keys, you actually have multiple keys in the ROM. You can invalidate old keys and replace it with new keys. One component specific to the Toradex model is that once you have fully enabled secure boot in the device, you are no longer able to run Toradex Easy Installer. Since that is not an image that is going to be signed with your keys, that's an image that we provide. The module, the SoC, will refuse to run that since it's not properly signed. So just those are some things to keep in mind. In fact, in the demo, I'll show you how I'm doing it without actually enforcing it. I'm actually just running it in a test mode where I can see the failures, but it still lets the device boot. And obviously, that's important when you're actually developing this and testing it in your CI/CD systems and all your workflows. So a little bit more detail. Let's kind of jump through each step here. The very first step here is where we are checking the bootloader signature in the SoC ROM code. And it's interesting to note that this is the only hardware-specific step in the secure boot chain, which is nice for us, because that means when we are switching from the NXP chips to the TI chip, this is the only component that needs to be modified. The rest, all the verification, the kernel, the root file system, that's all standard code that are part of the projects associated with them. It does require SoC support. You see which ones have V4 and which ones have AHAB. I'm actually demoing on an IMX8 Mini today, so we will be seeing have V4. And I mentioned we're actually fusing that public key into the SoC via some commands in U-boot. I've already done that. We'll see what the commands are. They're enabled by default when you run the builds that we provide that have secure boot. And this is really the root of trust of the entire system. So if there was some way for those public keys to be modified, then that would break the entire boot chain, which is why that is really, strictly speaking, a one-time operation. So, but once the SoC ROM comes up, it's going to validate the boot signature of the bootloader itself. Assuming the bootloader signature passes, then it's going to go ahead and launch the bootloader. So when you do your build, the bootloader image will be signed with the private key, which is never leaves your development machine, and the associated public key with that private key is flashed into the ROM code. And so now we're running the bootloader, and you see that the bootloader similarly has public key 2 embedded in it, and the Linux kernel, device trees, and things like that. It's a little more complicated than this diagram shows, but I think this gives the sense. So we're actually using standard U-boot functionality here called a fit image. It's basically an archive format that allows you to put multiple artifacts in the single image. So you can put the kernel, you can put the DTB, you can put an init RAMFS if you need it. You can put that in there. And so that public key that is now in the bootloader is able to verify the signature on the components of that fit image, whether it's the kernel or the device tree. And so all that hashing and signature verification happens in the bootloader. If all that succeeds, then now we move on. Now the Linux kernel has been built with a public key built in. I believe the actual mechanism is the public key is part of the device tree, if I'm not mistaken. But now that the public key is available to the Linux kernel, we're actually able to check the root file system signature and verify that the contents of the root file system are unmodified. And this also uses standard Linux kernel features. We're not doing anything terribly out of the ordinary here. We're using something called ComposeFS, which you see the quote there, read-only mountable file system trees stacking on top of an underlying lower Linux file system. And then that makes it very easy to run FS Verity, which is a feature of the Linux kernel that allows you to essentially verify the signatures on every single file in the file system. And typically with secure boot, it only provides guarantees at boot time. So all these checks are done at boot time and they're good. But if something comes in while the system is running and modifies a file on the file system, generally speaking, secure boot does not have anything to say about that. But because of the fact that we're using FS Verity in the Linux kernel, that gives us the additional benefit of being able to provide that runtime verification of the file system, file signatures on disk. So if something happens to modify a file, FS Verity will actually catch that. So just to give a little bit more detail, this is an animation that our TechPubs team put together. We've got a 3 or 4 minute YouTube video that I've got linked in the references. If you're wanting to pass this information off to somebody and they just have a few minutes, that YouTube video is a very good way to see at real quick what's happening. So the idea is, you know, this is kind of a very similar diagram to what we just saw. We start here with the SoC ROM. We're going to check the bootloader signature. The key matches the signature. Now the bootloader's good and launches. Now it's going to be checking the signature on the kernel, and similarly for the root file system. And now our system is up and fully booted. Now in the case that we have been attacked by some kind of hacker who is going to, in this image, they're going to install a malicious bootloader, which is signed, but it's not signed with the proper key. So this replaces our bootloader. Now that signature check will fail, and at that time the boot will be paused, and the at that point the device needs to be manually taken back into service and possibly destroyed, because you don't know what the status of the device is at that point. So is secure boot all I need? I mentioned at the beginning that it wasn't, so I don't think it's surprising that the answer here is no. Security, of course, is never done. It's a process mindset. It really needs to be part of your thinking from day one when you're building your devices and designing them. Secure boot is just one security measure that's part of the overall security stature of your design. You know, that includes things like credential management. I mentioned that. We've got keys that need to be managed here. You need some mechanism for storing, archiving, backing those things up. You need means to rotate them if they do get exposed, and that kind of thing. Secure coding practices, right? All your developers that are writing code, they may not be security experts, but they should have a security mindset. You know, keeping in mind, you know, common types of coding errors that cause issues, off by one errors, buffer overruns, things like that. There's lots of good resources on that. Regular patching and updates, obviously very important. I mentioned that Torizon does include over-the-air updates. Secure boot is great for making sure that what's installed doesn't change, but if you have, you know, if a vulnerability is discovered at some later date in the Linux kernel, in Chromium, in some application, you need some means of getting those updates built and delivered to your devices. Principal of least privilege, I always like to mention this, especially in the context of containers, because it's very... It's very tempting when you're developing in containers to basically run everything as root and do things that we all know we shouldn't be doing. So follow the principle of least privilege. Only give devices the access they need to do the things they need to do. And finally, always use well-vetted crypto and security algorithms. I think it was Bruce Schneier that has the comment that anyone can develop a crypto algorithm that only they don't know how to break. So make sure you're not trying to reinvent the wheel. There's lots of good crypto and security algorithms out there. So make sure you're using, where possible, something that has been inspected and vetted. So what are some of the attacks prevented by secure boot? I think it's kind of been implicit in everything I've talked about so far. But really, the goal of secure boot is to detect any modification of anything essentially on the disk. So the bootloader environment, which also contains the boot scripts, which control how the device is booted. So, you know, if we don't protect the boot scripts, then potentially attackers can boot off of an external device, and now they're maybe running unsigned code on that external device. So we have to protect that. We also obviously want to protect the kernel, anything associated with that, the device tree, overlays, the initram fs if you're using one, and then also files in the root file system. That I think that's kind of the one that most people are thinking about. And it's important to note that the way we have it implemented, secure boot generally protects against physical access to the root file system, either from a local command line or even in a real hardcore case, somebody that's actually able to depopulate the flash chips and read them off and write to them, you know, using some kind of external flash programmer. Because of the way secure boot interacts with the SOC and that hab layer, even if they were to do something like that, the image signatures would fail. So at boot time, the image would not succeed. So, you know, it doesn't do anything to stop attackers from actually modifying the flash, especially in the case of, you know, removing the flash chips. We can't do anything about that, but what we can do is refuse to run. And then it also protects the files from, you know, remote access attacks where, you know, there's some kind of vulnerability that allows untrusted code to run on your device, and that untrusted code then, say, modifies, you know, some binary, you know, maybe the PS binary to hide its processes or things like that. So those are the attacks that secure boot will prevent. But what kinds of things does the secure boot not help with? Largely speaking, any attack after the boot process finishes and is verified. So that basically means any runtime attack, right? So the system is up and running in steady state. The boot has been verified and it's happy. But now an exploit in the Linux kernel allows somebody to execute some arbitrary code. And that system can then whatever they are, whatever arbitrary code they have can then run out of RAM, and that doesn't affect the device, the device's block storage. The one thing it does do is it does make it more difficult for any such attack to survive a reboot. So, you know, the attack can live in RAM, but then you reboot and it's gone. I just want to mention again, updates are critical to address these exploits. because these new exploits are being discovered all the time. So, you know, a combination of secure boot and a robust update strategy will go a long way. So let's talk about the demo workflow. I think we got plenty of time. Good. So generally speaking, these are the main steps you're going to use. You're going to generate a set of keys and certificates. Some of that is using NXP tools. Some of that is using Torizon tools. Once you've generated the, actually, let me rephrase that. The generating the keys and certificates is done entirely with NXP tooling. That's a set of tools that you have to download from NXP. That's generally under NDA. You use those keys then with a custom Torizon OS build using Yocto. And as part of that build, all the signatures are applied to all the components, the bootloader, the kernel, everything else. And some instructions to close the device are actually going to be generated at this point. And then the output of that build is an easy installer image. And then you just use Toradex easy installer like you always would. The one thing to note is that simply flashing the image with the easy installer does not close the device, meaning it does not program the public key into the SoC and it does not instruct the SoC to only boot signed images. The generated instructions must be manually used at the present to do that. And that's a, you know, just another a way of making sure, because of the limitations I mentioned earlier about this is a one-time operation, you need to test this very carefully. And at that point, you are properly live in a secure boot system. So let's jump into the demo. So what I have here is just a login on my Veriden IMX8 Mini. My high security password that I always use on my test images. Actually, before we do this, I'm going to come over here and let's take a look at the build side of things a little bit. So I've got here my build. And if we look at my auto.conf file, we'll see all the changes that I added. So these are all the variables you have to set to allow Secure Boot to work. Most of these are default values. So you may not have to actually sign them. In some cases, you may be able to get away with just using this inherit TDX signed. This is all part of the Meta Toradex security layer. So if we look in here, we see all the different VB classes that are associated with this. So TDX signed is kind of the parent VB class. That's the one you actually need to include. And then you can control whether U-boot signing is enabled, whether actual HAB enablement is done. These are by default set to one. I have them here because I was jumping between enabled and not enabled, putting this demo together. And then you specify things like the key size, the digest algorithm, where the keys are actually stored, and that kind of thing. And, you know, assuming you already have those keys generated, you just do a standard build. Now, let's go take a look at the CST directory here. I just went ahead and put everything under Git just so I could monitor it. So this is the actual code signing tool from NXP where you actually generate the tools. And if we just take a look at my Git history here. Okay, so I did something not quite right, but I just want head. That's what I did wrong. So these are essentially the commands that I use to actually generate these certificates. These came directly out of the NXP documentation. There's nothing terribly exciting here. You know, you give it ideally a random serial number, generally a much more secure password than I'm using, but for testing this was fine. Then you run this have4pkitree.sh script. You can run this without any command line options and it will prompt you for all the bits of data it needs, but so I'm specifying that I'm not using an existing certificate authority, so it's going to generate one for me. I am using the key type of RSA with a key length of 2048 bits, a duration of 2 years, and I am generating four keys at the same time. SRK is a super something key. I don't remember what it stands for. And so that's going to generate the main PKI setup for this. Note that each of the NXP SoCs can store up to four keys. And the nice thing about that is that does give you the ability to invalidate a key should it become exposed. And then we run this SRK tool, which is going to generate this table and this fuse bin, which is instructions on, which basically becomes the instructions on how to flash the fuses here. And then we're specifying some other parameters. The digest algorithm SHA-256, that's the default. And then we're just passing in the actual names of the keys that were generated as part of the previous step. And this is just saying use use version one of the HAB, which is what I need for HAB V4. So once I've done that, all the keys are put into the directories here. You know, we can take a look. So there's all my keys. So now if we go back to my Kirkstone build here, and we cat that auto.conf file again, we see, you know, all of these data points correspond to the keys that were generated. And so once I run my build, it will build the appropriate components, sign things, and it will generate a file in the deploy images directory. So if we look at Verdin, mm, deploy images, fuse command, oh, Verdin mmm, fuse commands.txt. So this is that set of instructions that show what commands you need to invoke at the bootloader to actually fuse the public key into the SOC, which is these first, in this case, what, 8 commands here. And then, so that actually programs the public key into the SOC. At this point, though, it is not enforcing. It's only when I do this last step, which I have not done on my board intentionally, this will make it so that the board will only ever boot images signed properly with a private key associated with this public key. So this is something when you're enabling this on your design, you will need to test this very, very carefully and make sure all your processes and procedures are in place before you actually run this final command. So once you do that, you use Toradex Easy Installer as always. And I've already done that here. I've already booted. So I'm going to go ahead and reboot. We'll drop into U-Boot. And then we can kind of see U-Boot doing some interesting things here. So we'll drop into U-Boot before it tries to boot. So now we kind of come up here. You see here that we are authenticating image. In this case, that's the SOC ROM authenticating the bootloader image itself. And since it passed, it went ahead and started the bootloader. I interrupted the bootloader before it could actually test everything. But now we can take a look at the HAB status command. And ideally, you would see no HAB events found. That means that everything so far is good and the HAB system is happy. Now we'll go ahead and boot and we'll let this thing boot. And then what I'm going to do is I am going to play the role of a hacker here. And I am going to overwrite the kernel fit image in the boot partition of this device. So I have built two different configurations here, one with secure boot and one without secure boot. And in both cases, I have the kernel image. So if I look at, let's just take the MD5 sum. So this is the actual MD5 sum of the kernel fit image that's on the device now. So that MD5 sum started with 0A73. Let's go ahead and log in here. So if we come back here into the boot partition where the kernel is actually stored, and we take the MD5 sum of the VM Linux file, it is also starting with 0A73. So now we're going to overwrite that file. Let's see, do I have this in my command history? Yes, I do. But I have to be in the proper directory for it. Okay, so now I'm going to actually just force overwrite that kernel image with an improperly signed fit image. So now, if we come back over here and we take a look at the MD5 sum, now we see that that MD5 sum has changed. So, as I mentioned, you know, the fact that that file on disk has changed does not affect the runtime at this point. So the system is still up and running, your containers are running, and the system's happy. It's only at reboot time that we'll actually see the signature verification failure. So we see something interesting. So we come back up here, we just like before, we see the authentication of the bootloader. Everything worked good there. And now the system does its normal boot. And now we're starting to load the kernel fit image that we overwrote. And we see that the system fails to verify, in this case, the first component it tried to verify was the device tree binary, and that failed the validation, and so the system will not boot. So at this point, my system is dead. I'll have to actually reflash it with Toradex Easy Installer to get it back up and running. Since I did not actually close the device completely, I can actually do that. So when you're setting this up in your environment, this is really the way you're going to want to test it. Eventually you'll want to test the root file system verification and things like that. So that's it for the demo. Let's move on and talk a little bit more mechanics. So a little bit more about, you know, specifics related to Torizon. So we have split the secure boot up into different support levels. So we've got basic chain of trust on the left, enhanced chain of trust on the right, and full chain of trust in the enhanced in the middle and full chain of trust on the right. So the items in the light green are what are available today. So verification of the boot ROM, the bootloader, and the kernel artifacts, which we saw in the demo, that's all done today. Bootloader hardening, I haven't mentioned that yet, but bootloader hardening is basically we're removing things in the bootloader, commands that could potentially be security risks when you're dealing with a secure boot system. So only certain environment variables in the U-boot environment can be overridden, things like that. There's more details about that on our website. And it's a fairly new feature, but we will be enhancing that over time. A couple things that we do not, as of now, have, if you're watching this webinar recording in the future, that may or may not be the case, the ability to protect the kernel CLI arguments. That's something that I haven't mentioned much yet, but obviously if you can change the kernel command line, you can change what the kernel does, and there may be some attack scenarios in there. Today, we support the ComposeFS and FS Verity validation of /user, but it's not enabled by default. We have some work to do to get the OS updates to work in the presence of full FS Verity verification of the file system /user. So there's some interactions between this and OS tree that we still have yet to work out. Eventually, we will be protecting /etc, which is where all your config files are, and there's obviously work to do there to figure out which config files does it make sense that could be changed, which ones should never be changed, things like that. Obviously, to get proper validation of the root file system, we want to be able to support both of those. And the final level of this is the full chain of trust, where we will additionally be able to verify the container images, and the actual details of how that's going to be implemented are unknown at this point, but that is something that is coming fairly soon. Status on our hardware, you see here, the boards on the left are all fully supported to the level that was mentioned on the previous slide. The boards on the right, Palace IMX6 and Calibri IMX6, have a little bit of, I think it's mostly automated testing that needs finishing up. So feature-wise, I believe they're in fairly good shape, but there's just some due diligence stuff on our part. And Verdun AM62, at the moment, we have not begun work on that. And the Titan EVK that was just announced yesterday, obviously we don't have support for that yet. So that is coming soon. We do want to add it. We do want to support it across all the platforms supported by Torizon. So just briefly, talking about cloud compatibility, all the updates today are still possible, even with Secure Boot implemented. As I mentioned, we don't have the validation fsverity on the slash user enabled by default to make sure that updates continue to function. We are working on a means to support that properly. So, you know, application updates, OS updates, both online and offline updates are intended to be supported. Bootloader updates, assuming you're installing a bootloader that's signed properly with your trusted keys, that will continue to work. The, you know, one of the main goals here is to not break any existing platform features by enabling secure boot. So, and you see that any signature failure should trigger an update during rollback. Should during an update trigger rollback so that you roll back to a properly signed image and your device is not left in an unbootable state. So today, as we talked in the demo, you have to do a full Yocto build to get this. It's not clear if Toradex, Torizon Core Builder, Torizon OS Builder will support signing all the artifacts directly, or if you will always need to go back to Yocto. That's still kind of an up in the air thing. But we do want to eventually support at least re-signing images with Torizon Core Builder so that you don't have to do a full Yocto build every time. But today, that's not quite available. And I mentioned the limitations with Torizon, with Toradex Easy Installer. You cannot automatically close the device. And once a device is fully closed, you can't enter recovery mode and launch the Toradex Easy Installer today. So, just kind of wrapping up here, a little bit of detail. We talk about authenticity and integrity guarantees, both with Secure Boot and with the cloud. But really, what's the difference? Everything we've talked about today related to Secure Boot has to do with the booting image, you know, the contents of the block storage in the device. So Secure Boot will provide protection once an image is installed. The authenticity integrity guarantees provided by the Torizon Cloud refer to the update. So, you know, you want to make sure when you're installing an update, as well as when you're booting it, that authenticity and integrity have been verified. So, you know, without Secure Boot, obviously, as it says here, you could just reflash the whole OS and get access to the device. So Secure Boot makes sure that that is not an attack scenario that a malicious agent can use. And note also, just to avoid confusion, there are keys for both Secure Boot and Torizon platform, Torizon Cloud. They are different keys and they really have no relation to each other. In your key management model, you should definitely keep those separate. So some references here. I encourage you to take a look at all of these. These are all a good point to get started. The YouTube demo, I believe, was posted in the chat. So if you want to save that for sharing with your colleagues, like I mentioned, that's a good 3-4 minute video to give a real quick overview of everything we've discussed here. Call to action here. You can get started with us all today. Obviously, it's supported on Toradex hardware, full integration, full testing. You can request sample hardware from your local account reps. We also have some limited support on non-Toradex hardware, things such as the Raspberry Pi, Kimu, BeagleBone even. That's available in our project that we're calling Common Torizon. We do have some pre-built images available for both Toradex and non-Toradex hardware. And as far as getting access to the Torizon Cloud, there's free trials. With full remote access, OTA updates, device monitoring, and that kind of thing. The link there, Torizon.io, is the best place to go. That's kind of the central gathering point of absolutely everything. And from there, you can spread out to get whatever other information you need. So with that, I think we've got about 15 minutes left for Q&A. So we've got a number of questions here in the in the chat, so I will just jump through here. Okay, so there's a question about licensing models. I am not the best person to answer that, but I will just kind of briefly mention that the Torizon OS is completely open source. You can use it without any restrictions. All our layers are open. You know, you can do your own custom Yocto builds, and you're fine there. In terms of the Torizon the Torizon Cloud, the Torizon platform, that is a paid for service. basically, it's a certain amount of cost per device per month, obviously with discounts based on volume and things like that. We can certainly get you more information about that. The Torizon Cloud itself is not open source, but it is based on open source components. It's based all on the Optane specification and all the reference implementations for the Optane service. So if you want to go to optane.github.io and learn more about that, that's all out there. Okay, question. Shouldn't everyone have regulatory requirements once the EU CRA enters into force? I don't know the details of that myself, but certainly it seems like anyone that's doing business with the EU will certainly need to deal with that. So for those that said they had no regulatory requirements, you might want to look into things like that, because that's certainly something to consider. How does Secure Boot relate to Trusted Platform Module and other hardware-based security features? I mentioned it in the slide, but just real briefly, I'll go over it here since someone did ask. Trusted Platform Module is not required for us. We use the built-in components of the SoC. I believe a Trusted Platform Module is used in a lot of cases on desktop PCs and servers and things like that. I'm not terribly familiar with it myself, and I believe the TPM architecture provides a lot more functionality that allows users to actually encrypt with keys that are not visible outside and things like that. So it's useful for a lot more than just secure boot. Is it possible to create a signed copy of the Toradex Easy Installer? At the moment, no. That's something that's being discussed. The implication being, once you have flashed your the fuses in your SoC, you cannot go back and do a full image. We are looking at ways to handle that. I don't have any good answers for you today. But keep your eyes open, hopefully we'll have a better answer soon. Next question: impact time on startup. It's pretty minimal. I think you guys saw when I did the boot there. The signature verification at boot time is pretty low. I haven't actually measured it myself. I don't know that we have either internally. We probably have, but it's not something we've done any formal testing on. But it's compared to the existing boot up times, it's my guess is it's on less than a second total, but that's just a complete guess based on booting a few systems here over the last couple of days. Okay, there's a question about key management, especially for secure boot. And I am not the security expert, but key management obviously is very important. I mentioned a few things during the talk, air-gapped machines for very high security keys, especially that low-level root of trust key, that's important. Also the ability to rotate them should they become exposed somehow. And then just general discipline about maintaining access to them, who has access, whether backed up, that kind of thing. Those are the main things that I would think about when it comes to dealing with crypto keys. Okay, what happens when a key expires? So that's there is the ability to store multiple keys in the boot ROM. So you just need to make sure you're properly rotating keys out if and when they expire. Given the limited number of keys in the device, honestly, I don't have a good answer for what a good amount of time should be for the expiry on those keys. But there is the ability to rotate the keys out. So an attacker managed to get root shell access to my device, exploiting some vulnerability. Can secure boot help me deal with that situation? Yes and no. So this kind of falls into the bucket of issues that may or may not be protected for by secure boot. If the vulnerability only affects code in RAM, then you might be running untrusted code until you reboot the system. Since it's only in RAM, you're protected. But if they are able to actually overwrite files in the file system, with our implementation using FS Verity, any further access to the modified files will be denied by the system. So you even get a little bit of runtime protection against that. But certainly once you reboot the system with the modified files, then the signature checks will fail. Is it possible to test all the elements of the chain of trust except the signing of the bootloader before actually programming the fuses? Not exactly. You can, as I showed in the demo, you can program the public key into the SoC and not actually close the device. So that very last command in that fuse commands file, if you don't execute that, you are able to test the chain of trust. But without actually putting the public key, fusing the public key into the SoC, you can't actually test it. So when will it be available on Verdant AM62? I don't have an answer for that. I don't know if any of my colleagues have more recent information than I do, might be able to post an answer in the chat. If you have a specific need for that, please feel free to reach out to your account rep and let them know, and they will be able to provide that information back to the product management team to help prioritize the efforts on that. There's a question here. Who is verifying hash integrity of the U-boot image? So that's actually being done by the ROM code in the SoC itself. So that's the public key that we flash into the SoC. The U-boot image has been signed with the associated private key. And so before U-boot even starts, there's code that runs in the SoC that is able to verify that that image. So that's all the code that I mentioned that is under NDA from NXP. It's not open source. It's not necessarily available without lots of legal paperwork between you and NXP. But it's the interface to it is fairly straightforward. So that's why we were able to actually implement that in the full Yocto build. Can we use Secure Boot with custom Torizon builds with Torizon Core Builder? Not today. So you have to do the build actually at the Yocto level to get all the signatures applied. As I mentioned, we do want to eventually support at least re-signing images with Torizon Core Builder so that you can make the standard Torizon Core Builder modifications and then re-sign your image. Whether we'll support taking an unsigned image and being able to apply the signature to it, I think that's undefined at this point. Are there plans to support automatically closing the devices with Easy Installer? And I think this is also related to the question of signed Easy Installer. There have been discussions for both. I don't think we have any specific plans at the moment. But based on customer requests and user needs, we will certainly be able to prioritize that. So, you know, as with the AM62 support, if that's something you have a fairly near-term need on, please feel free to reach out and let us know so we can help get that prioritized. Is there support for this on non-Torizon Yocto BSP? And if not, will it be available in the future? So we have a couple of different things. We do have what we're calling the Torizon OS reference image minimal, which is essentially Torizon without the containers. And that working model is to do a full Yocto build. And so that still supports OS Tree and all the things that are in Torizon OS, but does not have the Docker container runtime in it. It is supported for that out of the box. Is the standard Yocto, Torizon Yocto build. As for our reference Yocto images, it's not an out of the box configuration today. We have in the past helped certain customers get it implemented, and obviously all the components are there since Torizon is a Yocto build. But we don't have anything out of the box. It is being discussed, and how exactly we're going to handle that in the future is still to be defined. How well is it integrated with OTA update? I mean, as I mentioned, the one of the prime objectives here is that all of the OTA update functionality continues to work, whether that's, you know, application updates, bootloader updates, subsystem updates, offline, online. The Torizon OS development team will not break functionality. And that's why, for instance, we don't enable file system verification out of the box today, because we're still working on a proper solution for that. So today, all OTA update functionality is still functioning within the limits of the basic chain of trust implementation. And as we expand that chain of trust to the more full featured versions, we will be maintaining all ability to do over the air updates as well. Okay, just a few more minutes. Let's see. Clarify the U-boot changes needed to implement hardening. I've read some of the documents. I'm not the biggest expert on this, but basically there's a white list of commands that are allowed. So only certain commands can be invoked by end users. The U-boot environment is protected. Only certain environment variables can be overridden. I think I also mentioned the kernel command line, which is generally created by boot scripts in the bootloader environment. So there's some additional protections that will be implemented eventually for the kernel command line arguments to make sure that we're not allowing users to do unsafe things with kernel command line arguments. There is documentation on that. If you look at the Secure Boot on Torizon Core link that is in the chat, on that page, there is more detail about hardening, and I expect that that page to fill out over time as we add more functionality there. So last question, without doing the final fuse step, the actual closing of the device, but just the key values, the device can still boot an unsigned image? And the answer to that is yes. In my case, it failed and I just left it there, but there are ways to get that to happen. So once you program that fuse in, you will be checking it every time, but until you completely close the device, there are always ways to get the device booted. Worst case, in my case, I'm just going to simply rerun Toradex Easy Installer here later today to fix that kernel overwrite that I did, and that will still work for me because I have not fully closed that device. And last question, this is a good one, came in at just the very last minute here. What is the workflow for enabling this retroactively on fielded devices? That's an interesting question. In theory, you can install all the signed images over the air because we do support bootloader updates. However, invoking those fuse commands will be very difficult to do on a field device. That's gonna generally require hands-on access because you've got to be able to drop the device into the bootloader prompt to be able to invoke those commands. So that's an interesting question. If that is a use case you have a definite need for, please reach out. That's a new one to me. I haven't thought about it. I haven't discussed it with anybody. If that's something that should be on our radar, please reach out and let us know. And with that, I think we are right at the time. And fortunately, we are right at the end of the question list. So I want to thank you very much for your time and attention. There's lots of ways to get in touch with us. You see them all on this slide. If you have further questions about this or anything Toradex related, feel free to reach out. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.